Thanks, Andy, for the flattering introduction. And for those of you who did not quite get my name, I'm usually referred to as TD for obvious reasons. All right, so Andy already covered this. I'm one of the PMC members of Spark, lead developer of Spark Streaming, was in AmpLab, and currently at Databricks. So can I see a show of hands who does not know what Spark Streaming and DStreams are? There are a few. Good thing I have a short introduction, but for the benefit of all, I'll cover them pretty fast. So, what is Spark Streaming? So, in a single line, Spark Streaming is a scalable fault-tolerant stream processing system. And what makes it unique is these three things. One, high-level API that makes it, like you get joins, windows, all of streaming joins, et cetera, right out of the box, often 5x less code, similar to the difference between Spark versus Hadoop MapReduce. It is fault tolerant, the system takes care of all kinds of failures, driver failures, executor failures, all of that. And then what makes it very, very unique is the integration with other Spark ecosystem, members of the Spark ecosystem, which makes it unique compared to any other streaming system that you have heard of. And so it can take data from Kafka, Flume, Kinesis, HDFS S3, Twitter, you can build your own receiver for it and push out data to any databases, dashboards, file systems. And so how does it work? At a very high level, what Spark Streaming does is that it runs these things called receivers, whose job is to receive data streams. The receivers divide the data stream into chunks or batches of, let's say, 1 or 2 seconds that is configurable, pushes them into Spark. Spark then takes these batches, treats them as RDDs, and runs your standard RDD operations on top of it, and then spits out the results to whatever database file system dashboard you wish to, again in batches. To take a very quick look of how the code looks like, streaming word count with Kafka, it is actually just hardly 5 lines of code. You can create a Kafka stream by specifying Kafka parameters, what broker to connect to, what zookeeper to connect to, things like that. And what this line creates is a DStream, which is the Spark Streaming's abstraction of similar what is RDD to Spark, DStream is to Spark Streaming. And you can then apply these functional transformations to take the lines in the Kafka data, split it into words, split by space, and then do word count on top of it by mapping it to 1, and then doing a reduce by key, and then finally print a sum of those words on the screen, and then finally say, once all this computation has been set up, finally say that go ahead and start processing the stream. And that's it. That's all you need to do for running word count on Kafka. And you can write this code, I showed it in Scala, but you can also write it in Java, Python. And also you can, and it's a common misconception that you cannot write your logic in any other language, but using rdd.pipe, you can shell it out to any arbitrary stuff, any arbitrary external language through a shell. And so you can write your own custom logic through any other language as well. And as I said, the big thing is that it integrates with the Spark ecosystem. So what you can do is that you can join data streams with static data sets, because you can create an RDD data set in Spark and then apply it on any arbitrary streams, join it together, filter, etc. You can also combine machine learning and stream processing together, streaming machine learning algorithms. I'll talk about them a little bit. Even outside streaming machine learning algorithms, you can take any model learned using MLlib and then apply that on a data stream to do predictions and stuff. Then you can combine SQL with streaming by interactively querying streaming data using SQL. Like, for example, you can take a Kafka stream and register it as a temp table and then interactively query that table from SQL, Spark SQL. And you can also use data frames. Now that data frames are in Spark 1.3, you can also start using data frames. Look at the programming guide for more information on that. And this makes the Spark Streaming different and more powerful than any other stream processing systems that you can name. So a brief history of how this started. So back in AmpLab in late 2011, we decided that let's try doing stream processing on top of Spark. And Matei said that we need to make Spark faster for that. And poor, humble grad students just learning the way like us asked, okay, how? And then 6 months later, we did a lot of hacking and we built this prototype, which took us quite a while, but it we rewrote a bunch of the internals of Spark, but it allowed us to run really small jobs. So earlier, the smallest Spark job used to take a second, but then we reduced it to less than 50 milliseconds, and it has improved even further since then. So all these core improvements in the engine was open source as part of Spark 1.6 in the third quarter of 2012, right after summer. And then the Spark Streaming, the API and all the Spark Streaming as a library was finally open sourced in February with 2013 alpha release. And a small interesting anecdote. So I submitted the patch for Spark Streaming, a 7,000, almost 8,000 line patch on 1st January. Somebody got shocked by that. I don't know why. First day 2013, I wished Mati Happy New Year on the pull request, and 7,000 lines of code got merged within 7 days. Those were the golden days where that could be done. Now, 7 days, 7,000 lines will probably take a month at all. That was an alpha release, and then January 2014, we marked it as stable with Spark 0.9. So it's been more than a year. What have we done since then? So what is the current state of Spark Streaming since then? So I'm going to break this down talk into three parts. One is development, what all features have we added, adoption, how people have been adopting this, and roadmap, the road beyond. So first, development. So what have we added in the last 1 year? So we have added a very key contribution is Python API. So you can write your Spark Streaming code in Python. You can open, you can use sockets, files. You can do Kafka in Python as well, which you added in Spark 1.3. And other sources are coming into the future. We're going to add for all the native sources in Spark, we're going to add Python support for them. Second, we added streaming machine learning algorithms, which allows you to do continuous learning and prediction, which some of you might have heard, might have been in Jeremy Freeman's talk and seen some of them. So if you haven't, go take a look at the talk when the talk gets uploaded on YouTube videos, but that's very cool. Streaming linear regression was added in 1.1. Streaming came in 1.2, streaming logistic regression 1.3, so you can see one algorithm per release in some way. I don't know what it'll be good doing for 1.4, but hopefully there is at least one. And the other very cool thing that we added in this latest Spark 1.3 release is the Kafka Direct Stream. So earlier, the Kafka integration had a receiver-based approach. So this receiver is this long-running task that is continuously receiving data from Kafka, and it used to use the high-level Kafka consumer API for doing that. But ensuring fault tolerance in the case of driver failures when everything fails required using replicated journal, which makes sense in non-Kafka streams like Flume and stuff, where a replicated journal gives good fault tolerance. They're called write-ahead logs in Spark Streaming. Really good fault tolerance guarantees, but in Kafka it doesn't quite make sense because Kafka itself is a log. So in 1.3, what we did is we added this new direct approach that instead of using receivers at all, it treats Kafka like a file system. And so there's absolutely no receivers. What Spark Streaming does is directly query Kafka for the latest topic offsets, and then each topic is treated like a file, and a subset of that is read just like we read files in Spark. And so instead of Zookeeper, Spark Streaming actually keeps track of all the offsets that are read, which allows us to give both avoid using write-ahead log, as well as gives exactly one's delivery guarantees, and you can achieve end-to-end exactly one's guarantees using this method. There is no data duplicates and stuff. So this produces more efficient, fault-tolerant, exactly one's receiving of data from Kafka. Other library additions were Amazon Kinesis integration, which we did in Spark 1.1, then more fault-tolerant Flume integration, also in Spark 1.1, so we're continuously improving the integrations that are already present. Beyond library, in terms of system infrastructure, we obviously want to make using Spark Streaming more easier to use, more robust under all possible conditions and things like that. So we added automated driver fault tolerance in Spark 1.0. We added graceful shutdown where you want to gracefully shut down your streaming pipeline so that you don't process all the data that has been received, shut down, maybe modify your code and then restart the computation. That we added in also in 1.0. And then 1.2, I mentioned earlier, the journaling, or in this case called writer logs for ensuring zero data loss, even with driver failures. We added that in Spark 1.2. So in terms of contributions, in terms of the community specific to Spark Streaming, if you look at the number of contributors contributing to Spark Streaming alone, like Kafka and Flume and all the Spark Streaming related stuff put together, you can see there has been a steady increase just in that. But then again, some of the key contributors have been Databricks, obviously, Cloudera, Huawei, Intel, Pivotal. But that, again, does not give the full picture because Spark Streaming is essentially a wrapper over Spark, and so all contributions into Spark Core directly improve the improve and benefit Spark Streaming. So this actually gives the full picture of how much development is ultimately improving Spark Streaming. Finally, a lot of contributions are now coming as the form of Spark packages. You've heard about it in Mati's keynote today, but go take a look. There are lots of Spark Streaming related stuff in Spark packages as well. For example, alternate Kafka receivers which gives different sort of guarantees. There's a Camel receiver, there's a Cassandra examples, et cetera. So go take a look, and there's a lot of community development going on over there. Next part is the talk is who is using Spark Streaming? What is the industry adoption? So in Spark 2014, this is about 7-8 months ago, I guess, we did a survey among the Spark Summit 2014. Those who attended Spark Summit 2014, 40% of Spark users were actually using Spark Streaming in production or prototyping. And another 39% were actually evaluating whether to use it or not. So that is quite a huge fraction of Spark users, which already has a huge base, quite a large fraction of Spark users wanting to use Spark Streaming or actually using it. And since then, we have collected more information, and a lot of companies are using it in production right now, both in production as a prototyping, and I mean, I'm pretty sure I'm missing a lot of companies who are using it, but I just don't know of it in this slide, in this set of logos. So. But the industry adoption has been very rapidly increasing, and right now we know 80 plus known deployments of Spark Streaming at the very least, and it's increasing. I'm hearing new stuff every week. So to look into some of them of how they are using Spark Streaming, Intel China, they build big data solutions for large enterprises. And so they for different top businesses, they actually build these streaming platforms. And for example, there's a real-time risk analysis for a top online payment company. Obviously, I can't take names. I wish I could. Real-time deal and flow metric reporting for a top online shopping company. And so these sort of pipelines actually involve pretty complicated stream processing. Like for example, they have been doing SQL queries on streams. They build their own SQL streaming framework on top of Spark Streaming. Then joining streams with large historical data sets, that's a pretty complicated thing that would be much harder to do in some other stream processing systems. And in total, they are processing almost 1 terabyte per day, passing through Spark Streaming, running on Yarn, receiving data from Kafka, RocketMQ, pushing it out to HBase. So decently, so they have been running in production for a while. Another interesting use case is Pearson. And so for those who are not familiar, they're one of the largest publishing and education company, and they want to accelerate their push into digital learning. And so what they needed to do is combine student activities and domain events to continuously update a model for each student of how the student is learning, or what is more effective for each student and things like that. So they had implemented it earlier on Storm, but they did not like it. Don't ask me why. But now they have moved to use Spark Streaming. It's going to go into production very soon. And they chose Spark Streaming because Spark together combines batch and stream processing, machine learning, graph processing, all of which they are using in the same system. And so what they run actually on top of Spark standalone, They started with Mesos. I think they are moving to Spark Standalone. They take data from Kafka and push it out to Cassandra and Apache Blur. Again, this is running in production. The URL in the slide gives more details. Take a look when the slides get published. Another interesting and one of the probably the oldest production use case is ShareThru, which is a leading advertising automation company with an exchange platform for in-feed ads. And so this exchange platform requires you to requires them to continuously update the exchange bids, et cetera, in real time, and for which they use Spark Streaming, and they take data from Kinesis, which is very cool because in Spark 1.1, we added Kinesis, and immediately within a few months, they started using Kinesis in production, which shows what is the rate of adoption in production systems that Spark and Spark Streaming enjoys. And so they also take data from RabbitMQ and push it out to MySQL, Redis, Amazon SQS, and they run on top of Marathon, Mesos and Marathon. Finally, Netflix. I don't think this name requires introduction. So what they want to do, among many other things, of course, is learn trending topics and of what movies and shows are being watched in real time, so that they can give more up-to-date recommendations on what you should watch and things like that. Currently, they had built a custom internal stream processing system, but they are in the middle of replacing that with Spark Streaming. And for that purpose, towards the end of last year, they tested resiliency of Spark Streaming with Chaos Monkey. For those who are not familiar with Chaos Monkey, what it does, it randomly kills nodes in a cluster to see whether the cluster survives or your service survives or not. So that's a pretty tough test to stand against. And Spark Streaming handled all kinds of failures pretty well. And they have written a blog post on that. The blog post is in the link. Just search Netflix Spark Streaming, and you should be able to read the blog post. It's actually very informative. They did a very detailed analysis of what works, what doesn't, and things like that under different configurations. And so take a look. And so Spark Streaming is super fault tolerant. And probably the coolest streaming application is done by Jeremy Freeman from Freeman Lab in Janelia Farms. Some of you might have attended the talk in the streaming machine learning talk in the previous session. And Spark Streaming, and he combined Spark Streaming and MLLib to do streaming machine learning. But what this does is it uses laser microscope, scans zebra fish brain or even mouse brains, pushes the data into Spark Streaming, pushes it into interactive visualizations, and then it closes the loop by using the interactive visualization to actually pinpoint which neurons to actually kill. And it actually goes back and kills the neurons, and then the loop starts again, that how does the killing of the neuron affected the brain behavior of the zebra fish or the rat. And so that leads to these very, very, very cool visualizations, updating in real time, etc. And as part of that, he had actually built these streaming machine learning algorithms, which he has finally contributed back into Spark. And the amount of data can be very big, and it's growing with the bigger and bigger brains that they are dealing with, up to 2 terabytes per hour. And they're running it on up to generally 30, 40, but up to 80 HPC nodes. So in a very high performance computing environment. And so take a look at his past talks as well as the other talk that he gave in this summit. So, and to generalize why they're adopting Spark Streaming can be kind of summed up into these 4 points. One is easy high-level API. You don't have to deal with bolts for topologies and stuff. Unified API across batch and streaming, integration with the whole Spark ecosystem. And finally, ease of operations. You know how to operate Spark, you know how to operate Spark Streaming as well. You don't have to learn another system from scratch. So, third part, what is coming next? So, and the three things that we going to focus on as in the road beyond. Libraries, because we have found that libraries is what makes an ecosystem really, really rich and easy for end users to use. Operational ease, so that it is as easy to use for sysadmins and stuff as possible. You don't have to, it's robust under all possible conditions you might run it against. And obviously, performance. From the library side, we are going to focus really a lot on streaming machine learning algorithms, A-B testing, online LDA, and more streaming linear algorithms. Don't ask me about those. I'm not a machine learning person, what LDA is. Looking even further, we definitely want to incorporate streaming and data frames together in a more tighter integration, streaming and SQL. In terms of operational ease, there are lots of infrastructural improvements we are really looking forward to do, things like better flow control within the system. We want to elastically scale the cluster so that the system can adapt dynamically to your varying streaming workloads. Cross-version upgradability to make it easier to upgrade your Spark version without changing your code and recompiling everything without losing data in the middle. And then improved support for non-Hadoop environments as well, for environments where you want to run only Cassandra with the Spark Streaming and Kafka, so things like that. Performance, definitely we want to push to increase the throughput, especially for stateful operations, and ultimately lower latencies as well. And another very important thing that we want to focus on is easing the deployment of streaming applications on Databricks Cloud. That is definitely a no-brainer. We want you to be able to deploy your streaming applications very, very easily on the Databricks Cloud platform. Finally, you as part of the community actually can help us, because the roadmap is heavily driven by the feedback from the community. We have listened in the past to what community demands, like the write-ahead logs for zero data loss was definitely from the community demand. People who wanted to use in a zero data loss wanted those guarantees we added because of their demands, and then people demanded why have to use write-ahead log for Kafka. We added this new Kafka Direct API for that. So if you have any kind of features that you want to do, let us know, and we will figure out. There is obviously no promises, but it helps us really decide, prioritize our wish list of items. There are tons of things what we want to do, but it without your feedback, it's really hard for us to prioritize them, and therefore give us your feedback, tweet it to me, talk about it in a Spark mailing list, and we'll listen you out, absolutely. So to conclude, Spark Streaming industry adoption is increasing rapidly. Community contribution is committees computing very actively to even the Spark Streaming in itself. More libraries, performance, and operational ease on the roadmap. Thank you. I guess we have a few minutes for questions.
Yep, let's do two or three questions. There's a microphone right in the middle, and there's a microphone up front here. So if you have a question, make your way to a microphone, please.
Hi, I was wondering if you knew anything about Flume support and extend into that with Spark Streaming, and possibly how many TPS one receiver can take.
Flume support exists. In fact, over in 1.1, we added a better Flume support to make it more fault tolerant. In terms of throughput, number of records per second, definitely I have heard use cases going in the tens of thousands of records per second per receiver. Beyond that, I don't have exact numbers off the top of my head, but definitely in that range is definitely quite normal. 15 syncs per, in terms of number of syncs per receiver, I don't have numbers on that, but I can find out. But in terms of records per second throughput, definitely in the range of tens of thousands of records per second, easily.
Hi, my name is Vlad. I'm senior software engineer in PlaceIQ. Last 4 months, I'm trying to replace Camus. I think you know what is it, it's LinkedIn pipeline from Kafka to HDFS. Mm-hmm. Like till last Friday, basically Spark Streaming had no reliable Kafka's like forgot the word.
Receiver?
Yeah. So like before that, sorry. there were implementation with write-ahead log, without it, and stuff like that. So my main concern is actually stability, because streaming application should be running for a long time, There are a lot of problems regarding, for example, you're writing a lot of map outputs to a worker folder, which is not cleaned by default. And basically, you're running out of space on hard drives because of that. And like, basically, there is no clear way how should you upgrade your streaming application? How should you modelize it? Like, are there any plans to, like, because like, if you go into production, you should have your pipeline like stable and like understandable how to upgrade it, how to support it, like stuff like that.
So that is very good feedback. That and we can talk about it more offline on what is the exact environment that is causing these sort of issues. Why is like for example, disk cleanup based off. Cleaning up of map output files should work automatically. So I would really like to understand what is the situation that is causing that to not work. And that is exactly what I meant by to make Spark Streaming work more seamlessly in all possible environments. Because Spark Streaming plus Kafka, as I told you, Intel and many other companies have been running it in production for a while now, and they haven't seen issues. Like some of them have seen issues that have been fixed, and if your environment is creating a certain issues that is unique to your environment, we are ready to go ahead and fix them to make it work nicely on all environments and stuff. So that is definitely on the roadmap of making it easier to use operationally. Regarding instructions on how to use, that is definitely on my wish list on to make it easier to deploy, and maybe the thing is that we need better documentation, and there again, I want to talk to me after this is over, and I want to understand what are the things that are not clear from the existing documentation, and I promise we will update that in next release and stuff.
Thank you.
So let's do one more question or two if it's short. We'll start with the front one.
What do you see as the main drivers behind the Storm to Spark Streaming swap-outs that you're seeing now, and how do you see those drivers changing, improving in future, Storm to Spark Streaming?
I would say there are three things. In fact, I already showed that in the slide. There are three things. One is ease of use of the API. High-level API gives you joins, windows, et cetera, which you will have to implement, hand-code it in Storm yourself. Second is the fault tolerance guarantees. If you want to do any kind of stateful processing, Storm does not give any of those guarantees out of the box. It gives you interfaces that you have to implement using some external store to store the state, transaction bolts and stuff. You don't have that out of the box. You need to put together a lot of moving parts together and make it magically work to get
actually,
all of this.
Unfortunately.
Yeah, and topologies, people have creeped about topologies, how to set them up, what is the right way to set them up and stuff. Rather, our functional approach is more intuitive to people. That is second. Third would be operational ease. And here, I don't have really specific information because I haven't run Storm myself operationally, but I have heard many developers make it that it is hard to run and deploy Storm, and you have to learn it as a separate task. But here, you learn and deploy Spark. You just learn. You have learned. You don't need anything else to deploy Spark streaming. Maybe a few more things streaming specific, but you have already learned the 90%. So these three things is converting people from Storm to Spark streaming. And there are many people out here, Strata.io, et cetera, who have done that. So you can probably talk to Strata.io folks out here. And Intel folks out here, they have experience on doing both. So you'll get more specific feedback.
So unfortunately, we don't have time for your question. I apologize, but make sure to find TD offline and ask him in person. Let's thank TD one more time.
Thank you, folks.